Philly Pop Music, The Lost Pioneers. The greatest story never told until now.
Meet me on South Street, oh yeah, from your town. Meet me on South Street, hippest street in town.
Well, I'm going down to the city of
Philadelphia, birthplace of the nation, and host of landmark globally viewed musical events, Live 8 and Live 8. Our main objective is to record and preserve a part of Philadelphia's pop music and entertainment arts culture.
Thank you all. God bless you. Yo, Philly.
A American Bandstand. I mean, that as far as rock and roll, that helped put rock and roll on the map. In the world, not just the United States, because I've talked to people from overseas.
It was Bob Horn who invented and created Bandstand.
The whole Bandstand movement, American Bandstand, was significant early on.
I think was great for Philadelphia. Not so much that Bandstand was here or that Clark started here, there were record companies, but the show went national in Philadelphia.
The kids that dance on a show are bigger than life. This was Hollywood here. This was it.
Well, I think in life it's being in the right place at the right time. And Philly and American Bandstand definitely was the right place at the right time in the 50s, early 60s. I mean, it was incredible.
One of my first bands was called The Hurricanes. And in the band was the drummer, was Bobby Ritterelli, who was Bobby Rydell. And we were very close, all of us were very close at that time. It was Bobby Ritterelli, Frankie Avalone, Ernie Evans, which was Chubby Checker.
Chubby Checker sang his way from the Italian market to the top of the pop charts with his big hit, Twist.
It's in 2 minutes and 42 seconds, the twist changed the whole world. Dancing and Pop for the Beat was established.
It happened because of a man named, his name was Joe Scandori. Joe Scandori managed Frank Sinatra, he managed Don Rickles, he managed Pat Cooper, he managed Goldie Hawn, and me. And that's how I got to be one of the first females to play Las Vegas. And I still do.
So it goes back to the days when Cameo Parkway was here, Joe Tarja was the engineer. So we had a wonderful time here. And I'm just proud to say that we're still here and we're honoring all of the wonderful artists here in Philadelphia.
I mean, I've only made records with people that, you know, like, I can tell in 10 seconds whether or not I want to make a record with somebody. Because there's something that I feel, I get a reaction, and that's it. And if I get the feeling, I don't care what somebody else thinks. I don't mean to say that. I don't mean to say like I'm in a nasty way. It's just that when I recorded Roberta Flack, one of the owners at Atlantic Records got angry and said, she's a lounge singer. We don't need lounge singers. When I recorded Bette Midler, they said, you can't translate what she does live to a record. When I recorded the Neville Brothers, they said it's, you know, it's like kind of like folk music or something from New Orleans. It can't, you know, when I recorded Leon Redbone, they said, you know, this is an idiotic act, you know. So I've been hearing that crap my whole life. And it you know, I know that my taste is to the left, but there's a certain part of to the left that translates to the middle. So that's what I've always been drawn to, and I don't know how to make regular records, you know, so I try and make the records that I can make, you know.
So we cut Yes, I'm Ready to put out on our own label. Are you ready? Yes, I'm ready. But when Yes, I'm Ready came out, it was unreal.
The Barbara Mason's record of Yes, I'm Ready sort of exemplified what was to come later in and be called the Sound of Philadelphia.
Following the maturation of Motown, as the 60s became the 70s in Philadelphia, Kenny Gamble and Leon Huff with their associate Tom Bell created a new, even more sophisticated form of R&B, the Sound of Philadelphia, based on their Philadelphia International label.
I work with the Tramps, Earl Young.
Well, what we did, I tell you what we used to do. We had our sound.
At the core of the sound was the fabled Baker, Harris, and Young rhythm section.
The Baker, Harris, and Young here. And they had the left hand, this is the right hand, and then there was that left hand too. You know, for what you needed for certain songs. They needed Bobby Eli for some, they needed Roland for some, they needed TJ playing that rock stuff on the guitar.
Baker used to sit right next to me. So whatever I played on my bass drum, he would play on his bass, and we would rehearse that before we even record. Like if I'm playing, he would play. And then Norman would play in between that, like ding 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 ding. And Bobby Eli would play chinks. We call them chinks. Ding ding ding. He would sit and play. We call it play the chinks, Bobby. Ding ding. You know, I know Bobby used to hate that, but it sound good on the records. And this was the Philly sound, basically playing together. You know, playing together, and it was so tight.
So, it was a family in that studio, you know.
My brother called me up. He said, can you give me some kind of a cappella thing standing on a street corner? I said, okay. I didn't know what the hell he was talking about. I mean, because I knew nothing about a boxing movie at that time. So I put something together, take it back, Buddha, doo doo. I've been told by, take it back, Buddha. Well, let me adapt this. And what's really weird, George, is that's 1975, okay? He might have called me late 74 going into 75, because I started filming 75. And so I did that, forgot about it, and moved on. And the next thing you know, it was in the movie. All of a sudden, when this came out, it was bigger than anything we could ever imagine, ever. So all of a sudden, I became like a brother of a fictitious character. That's like, who's your brother? Like, you know, Spider-Man. I mean, how do you, you know, figure that? So it became a little tough after that. It didn't sink in until after a while. I'm going like, whoa.
Grover played the saxophone, it was as if he spoke, and you could sometimes visualize words coming out of his lips through a saxophone.
With this in mind, Philadelphia has continued to be the birthplace for many musicians, entertainers, and artists to America and the world. All facets of struggle and success stories of these artists and entertainers continue to create and survive in the fifth largest city in America, Philadelphia. I'm not your man.
It's easy being held, I got kind of cover.